Thank you for joining us for this month's edition of African Liberty Webinar. It's again a great pleasure to have the opportunity to discuss one of the issues currently in discourse in West Africa, particularly in Nigeria. We have a panel of amazing young individuals involved with numerous political, social, economic, and in some cases academic endeavors to promoting freedom in the country, driving discussion, and we'll be discussing the issue of godfatherism in Nigeria. Recently, there was an election in Southwestern state called Edo State, and the election has been analyzed by many commentators and observers to be some sort of a point of departure from the usual. And the usual, I mean, godfathers or some individuals asserting their powers or their say or their choice in the electoral process. So if you have someone that has been in the political space in Nigeria for over 20, 30 years, and they will say, I want this person to be the governor of the state, I want this person to be the elected representative, and oftentimes that will eventually turn out to be the case, because they just have too much influence in the electoral process, or maybe they do not. So today, we are pleasure to have with us Femi Adeyeye, who is a student rights activist and a member of the Coalition for Revolution, organizers of the Revolution Now movement and protests in the country. And Femi is a very good friend of mine. Bayole Fesobi, a regional director for African Students for Liberty, a good friend of mine also. And the remarkable Larry Lufison, who is the co-founder and executive director of Ominira Initiative, a think tank in Nigeria based in Ibadan. And of course, Daniel White, a fellow with us at African Liberty, and he currently works with the Premium Times Center for Investigative Journalism. And it's a great pleasure to have you guys. First of all, I want to go to Femi. So, I don't know if you actually follow, to what extent you follow the election in those states. But from what you can observe, your online presence is much more, up to date than mine. I really don't engage with social media as much as you do. So from what you've observed across the country in the media space after the Edo election, would you categorically say, or to what extent can you say that this election is an evidence of a departure from what used to be? Is a departure from the influence of godfathers in Nigerian politics? Can you categorically say that? Or to what extent are you going to say that?
All right, thank you very much. Good evening to everyone. To answer your question would mean, if I want to really answer it the way I want to answer it, it's then going to mean putting up an academic paper on godfatherism. But we're not going to do that tonight. But one thing is very important here, and it's the fact that what happened in Edo State actually is not any departure from godfatherism. In a constitutional democracy, or preferably let me say in a democracy that's supposed to be participatory, where the basic definition, which is that democracy is the government of the people, by the people, and of the people, what we were taught in school. The place of the people, and when I say the people, I'm talking about the majority, cannot, be overshadowed by the decisions, of some minority, and then we claim that it's a shift from godfatherism. What happened in Edo State actually is not a shift from godfatherism. It's just that godfathers only changed names, that's my opinion. They change names and they change addresses. It used to be one Adams Oshobole. Now we have another man from LMA in Port Harcourt, making decisions. So you don't, I saw so many things online and people jubilating that, now Edo is free from godfathers. And then, you said something, you were alluding to my online presence. So, and I thank you for that. So I interrogated some of my friends, and some of them said, yes, it's a shift. But even though there are still thugs in Edo State, but the PDP thugs do not attack people. So that's to tell you that they are alluding to the fact that, yeah, there are still godfathers. there are still thugs. You know, these were the issues then, that Obaseki is against Godfatherism, is against thuggery and all of that. But the thugs from the PDP side, they do not attack citizens. It's just like saying you have good rapists, that you have some rapists who would sing, who would sing, you know, good songs while they are raping their victim. It is still the same thing. So what happened in Edo State would have been regarded as, you know, a shift, you know, from the normal way of, you know, politicking in Nigeria, which is through Godfatherism, through a rigged system, totally a rigged system that has been rigged against the people, would have been, you know, considered that if it was truly the will of the majority. And what do I mean by the will of the majority? The will of the majority is that you look at, you know, one man cannot just wake up, you know, he ran with a manifesto, the manifesto of the APC 4 years ago. And he claimed that, yes, this manifesto is the best in the world, you know, the best thing has happened after Gary Jebu. And then overnight, just, you know, woke up and then said, no, PDP is now the best manifesto to run with. But I'm saying all of this to lay a premise, and I know you understand this so well, because you are in a particular society where manifestos really mean a lot. But here, we have not, maybe, let me just end it that way, that our political culture is not mature enough that people interrogate manifestos. So it's just an issue of, oh, we like that man. He speaks good English. He has charisma. You know, some people will tell you that time when we were running election during the electioneering with Sowore, some person said, someone really sent me a message and said, tell Sowore to stop taking pictures with Moncaris. Yeah.
I think we lost Femi there. Okay. I think he's a little bit frozen. But anyway, Femi, I got your point. And you actually made it.
You know, it's presidential enough. It's just to tell you that our political culture is not yet mature to that level. So what happened in Edo State, to wrap it up, is not, in my own opinion, is not, you know, a change in the political culture, which is of Godfatherism. It is just a change in the address and the location of Godfathers.
Well, that's a huge indictment, because many commentators on social media will say, okay, Oshiomhole said this was going to happen. And you have Oshiomhole and Tinubu. And of course, you know, in the Southwest, Tinubu is regarded as the godfather. In fact, in the entirety of the country, he's one of the leading so-called godfathers. So you have Tinubu and Oshiomhole saying that this is going to happen, this is going to be the result of this election. And it turned out to be the other way around. And Femi, you are saying that is not
Tinubu did not. You saw the video where he was begging, you know, the last minute video where he was begging Edolites, you know, the way they call them, to reject Obaseki. So Tinubu did not authoritatively. You see, we overrate these people most times. You see, they derive their legitimacy from the people, actually. But when you have a docile people, definitely they would always have their way. But at any point in time where people, for any reason, rise against these guys, they are out of the game. So Tinubu did not authoritatively say, this is what's going to happen. If he had said that, there would be no need for that video where he was begging Edolites to what, reject Obaseki. So that's what happened in Edo State. But what I'm saying is, the known godfathers have been relegated, quote and unquote, because Obaseki was asked if he was going to go back to APC. And he said he's not going anytime soon. Do you get that? Which means maybe by anytime soon might mean in the next, you right. understand? Right. So the godfathers were just relegated for new godfathers to take over. And in a matter of time, we'd all see it.
I mean, hopefully, I'm hoping that what you're saying will not be true, because I hope these guys just get out of the way and there'll be no more godfathers. But we have to be
quite 93, right. Up 93. We've started we've been open since 1993.
Anyway, Larry, do you agree with Femi saying that the so-called godfather are just relegated?
Yeah, I agree with some things Femi said, because in my own view, in Edo State, the elections in Edo State reflect that the people wanted to, put an end to the reign of certain godfathers. But the truth is, it's the beginning of a new era. You know, so yes, I agree with what Femi said, because the way Nigeria, we know our politics is in Nigeria, and godfatherism is a part of it. But what I also like is the fact that these godfathers understand the fact that they need to beg, as Femi said earlier, Tinubu had to make the video to beg the electorate to not vote Obaseki. That is to show that they know that the people have the final say. But you know, when it comes to the party politics, godfatherism is it works. I mean, it is how you decide determine who is going to get this or get the ticket or not get it. But yeah, godfatherism in Edo State, the election in Edo State is just shows that it's the end of the rain for some guys and the beginning for some others.
All right, so Daniel, you heard what Peter said, and I mean, of course, everybody saw the video from Tinubu. So okay, Tinubu and the APC towards the end of the campaign, they came out to implore Edo people. At the same time during the election, there were allegations or photos that emerged of, you know, APC chieftains and representatives, you know, giving out money to the public, to the electorate. So if you have APC and Tinubu coming out to admonish the Edo people to vote for them, in what, you know, Femi has regarded as, you know, them realizing that the people actually have the final say, of course, buttressed by Larry. So Daniel, do you think the same people that actually, you know, apologizing to being apologetic in the video for people to vote for them, people that are giving electorate money on the election day, don't you think there's a conflict here? If you think the people are actually owe the final say or have the final say, why would you on the election day be giving out money to them to entice them? So Daniel, do you think, indeed, considering this, you know, disparity, that you can say godfathers have finally realized that the decision making in the election actually relies with the electorate?
Yeah. Thank you very much for the question. So I quite agree with what Femi and Peter have been saying earlier. But my own port of entry would be that the question is on the power godfathers wield in given elections. So the question is not whether godfathers have powers in entire Nigerian politics. It's the particular context of the election. So if you look at Edo election concurrently to Ekiti election or Oyo State election, we look at there were godfathers at play. But the power they wielded was not substantial to the one the election we had in Lagos State. So while there's the argument that the electorate have the final say, I would still argue that this Edo State election is not really a departure from the fact that godfathers play a key role. This is not to say I'm advocating for them or I'm a godfather loyalist or so. But the clear fact is that we cannot extricate a given election from the context that surrounds it. So if we look at Osun State's election, for instance, now, there were blatant power politics at play during the Osun State election. We saw the fact that PDP won in quotes now at the first election. But when there was a rerun, there were some politics at play. Some people were settled and some people were implored, and then there was a final winner. And then before the election, just like Tinubu did for the Edo State election, he also made some comments during his visit to a royal father's house, so to say now. He made some comments that we want to install, or so, quote unquote now. I'm just paraphrasing what he said. So he was trying to employ the people of Osun State to accept Oyetola after Rauf Arebosola. He still understands that the people have the power to do and undo, but the role he played, or the role the big guns in the parties played during Osun State election, cannot be also underemphasized. So I think that's my point. So it's a two-way.
I absolutely agree with that. So Bayo, one of the things Femi said was about, okay, you know, Tinubu and Oshiomole on the one side, they couldn't, you know, have any significant impact on the outcome of the election. But you have Wike and maybe Sheyi Makinde and some other godfathers in the PDP that they are not Edo citizens. They came into the states. What are they doing in the states? Some have said to influence the election. So do you think, you know, Wike and the likes in some way influence the outcome of the election? And could that also, you know, make us to arrive at the conclusion that the so-called godfathers in APC are just relegated for now, that the so-called godfathers in the PDP are actually the ones determining what is going on in those states now. So generally, can that tell us that godfathers still exist as much as they used to do in Nigerian politics?
Thank you very much, Ibrahim. The case of the relegation of godfathers at the moment is a case that we really need to, you know, pay serious attention to. Of course, you know, the likes of Tinubu and the known names, you know, their times are seemingly going now. And we cannot rule out the fact that we now have new names coming onto the field. Now, if this is a shift, you know, like Femi did not agree the other time, if this is not going to be considered as a shift, then it will be considered as a change of address, all right? Times past, we have seen big names, keyword behind, you know, people during elections. Currently in the Ondo State elections, we also have some big names in the state politics, in the Ondo State politics, queuing up behind some, you know, contestants. And this is to show, now everybody, you know, there are about 10 of them, so to speak. And, you know, the camp is divided as to which of the camps would hold sway. So, you know, we have some persons who are regarded as maybe older godfathers, keyword behind a particular candidate. And then we have a kind of the newer generational godfathers, keyword behind another candidate. Now, the fact that the likes of Seyi Makinde, Wike came into for the electionary process in Edo State also points the attention to the fact that, you know, there is probably some forms of solidarity support or influence that they can weigh in for the election. Be that as it may also translate that this might be the startup of a new, newly formed caucus of godfathers. If care is not taken with the kind of administration these guys lead in their previous, in their domestic state, their domiciliary states, Rivers and Oyo, probably to be precise. Now, we might be forced to agree that they are becoming a force to reckon with, you know, and their entry into Edo State election also showed that fact that, okay, it seems the influence, the support, the solidarity that have, you know, showed in times of that election could actually mean a lot in determining, you know, the success or probably the outcome or the direction of the elections. Now they did this in the spite of the older generational godfathers. Now this translates to the fact that probably we are going to be having new sets of godfathers, or probably we are going to have a landslide of godfatherism entirely. Femi rightly said the other time that time will tell, and of course I'm still waiting for few subsequent elections, on those state elections and other elections that will come up, for us to be able to say categorically, or for us to be able to draw a line and say, yes, okay, we have had a shift, or we have had a decline, or we have had a relegation of the older generational godfathers. But of course, the weighing in of newer generational influential politicians, let me put them that way, would mean that they really have a say, or their influence really matter a lot in determining the direction of elections in whichever ones they pick interest.
So Femi, let me come back to you. You hear what Bayo said about maybe Wike and the PDP caucus are now, you know, maybe the new wave of godfathers in Nigeria, even though they've already been in existence for a while. And the Ondo State election is a few days away from now, maybe I think less than 10 days. So you have the Edo election where APC lost. And the body language from the APC now is that they will make a huge statement in Ondo to make sure the PDP realize that they are still in control. And the PDP have said, well, you cannot do the same. You cannot do what you did in Lagos in Ondo. You have to learn from what we did in Edo State, and we're going to bring that to Ondo State. Now, so that is a potential battleground for both parties in the next few days. So, Femi, do you think that this election in Ondo State will actually be a determinant of who, maybe APC or PDP, is now the so-called emperor of the old godfatherism in Nigeria, or we're going to see another defiance of the status quo by the, you know, electorate, by the youth? Are they gonna disregard both the PDP and the APC and say we don't want the two of you guys? We're gonna vote our conscience. Or do you think either of the two will actually also win this election again, as regards as the influence of their godfathers are concerned?
I'm finding it very, you know, difficult putting on this toga of a political analyst of this program. I would have loved my activist self, you know, because now that we're discussing which is a better godfather, which is another godfather, can we? The activist in me is finding it very uncomfortable. The activist in me is saying, why can't we just discard godfatherism in its totality? And then the decision of the people comes, you know, in front. But no problem, let me drop the activist in me and let's do the political analysis part of this. What's happening in Ondo elections is, in fact, it's just confusion. You know, the one man left as the deputy governor, went to PDP, did not wait till his results of his medical, what do you call this thing in football? He didn't wait for medical results, went to ZLP, and now he's confused because there is every possibility that Jegede would be, as in ZLP is going to adopt Jegede of PDP. You see, so all of these things are just clear, you know, clear signals to the fact that godfathers are just changing names. The masses, the poor people, the poor working people are not on the agenda at all. It's just an issue of godfathers changing names. And you said something about maybe the youths in Ondo states would reject the PDP and the APC and then say, okay, they want to go for another alternative. And if we would have to interrogate that, if that's going to be the case, but we all understand that as of today, these two parties are still the ones who have the wherewithal, you know, in this society. Wherewithal in this society is, when I say wherewithal, I'm talking about money, resources, reach, and all of that. They maintain all of these structures. It's not as if they have one structure like that. The last election made me understand this. But they can maintain all of these structures with money. Money that we're getting from what sources that, you know, of corruption. It's as simple as that. So what's going to happen in those states? I'm not going to speak prophetically. Let me speak prophetically. What's going to happen in those states is just another shift from one godfather to another. It's going to happen. Definitely, it's going to happen. And you can tell from the body language of Akeredolu. I don't know if you listen to that audio recording. He said, if I lose, I lose. If I win, I win. Whenever a sitting governor is speaking in that tone, you should understand what's about to happen.
Interesting. So let's just come back to the basics now. There is a question we should have addressed before going into the whole Ondo election. And that is the fact that, you know, the way we interpret godfatherism in Africa particularly is actually... it's actually different from the way it's interpreted in the West. For example, we all know that Trump wouldn't have won the U.S. election if it wasn't for the backings of, you know, some Republican heavyweights like Mitch McConnell and the Republican governors, frankly, Ted Cruz and all the other senators. And of course, Obama wouldn't have won the Democratic elections back to back if it wasn't for the support of the godfathers in the Democratic Party, the Hillary Clinton and Clinton family. The George Soros and Al Gore. So now, of course, in that sense, we can say that in some sense that there are godfathers in American politics, there are godfathers in the United Kingdom politics. So, to what extent, Bayo, do you think we can say, you know, some individuals that have been in politics for a while, they can, of course, you know, based on their experience, tell people, oh, this person is bad for you. Well, I've run for 10 years. And from my experience, I can say this person doesn't have the wherewithal. Those are personal opinions that we can actually attribute to some elements of godfatherism. And this happened in the US, it happened in the UK, it happens in France. But in Africa, it's just different because they tend to always stand on their opinion. If Obasanjo just says Jonathan will not win the election, well, maybe Jonathan will not win. If Tinubu says Ambode will not contest the election in Lagos State, of course he did not contend. So there seems to be... some similarity between the way old folks or elder statesmen have influence in politics in the West and, of course, in politics in Africa. And, of course, there seems to be a great disparity in the level of influence they do have. So, Bayo, do you think we are just, you know, being extra about, you know, regarding this so-called influencer as Godfatherism, or is something that exists elsewhere? Is it a problem, or is it just a normal thing that happened in politics?
I happen to be a student of politics, and we cannot override or overrule the fact that, you know, experiences matter. In fact, in leadership, experience is key. You know, the extent to which experience plays a very vital role is very essential. You know, you cannot really altogether rule out the fact that you need experienced people in your team. However, there is a thin line between mentoring and godfatherism. What I think we have in the West, which seems to be working, is what we call mentoring. But here, what we have is godfatherism, and that's the bad part of mentoring. Mentoring says you can guide, you can suggest, you can advise, you can compel. But godfatherism says you need to enforce, you need to forcefully direct, you need to orchestrate, you need to configure, you need to model. Now, all of these are, you know, against each other. If you check the way the elder statesmen of the Western politics would queue in or queue behind their supporters, you would find out that it's a way different from the way we do it over here. So you rightly mentioned the other time that if a particular elder statesman mentions or gives a statement, it's almost valid if care is not taken. Now, this is so because, Femi said, these are things that are peculiar to our own politics that are not existing in the Western politics. These people have the way without. They can sustain the structures they are using to influence these decisions or these thoughts with the corrupt money they have in their pockets. Now, those who are not who are probably just mentors, they may not be able to, you know, spend or maintain a structure from a corrupt funding as they can. So it's difficult to match mentors with godfathers. They exist almost everywhere. Academics, politics, social life, religion, every aspect of life, we have two categories of leaders. Is it that you are a godfather or you are a mentor? In the West here, in the African politics, what we have are godfathers. Those who enforce their decisions, those who instill their positions, their opinion on a particular direction above everybody's thinking, irrespective of whose ox is gone. As long as it is in their favor, they are ready to pull it out. But, you know, as against the other way around, which is the ideal. Now, Femi wanted to relinquish his activism part the other time. I won't relinquish mine. I am totally not in support of godfatherism. And that's my stand. Either they are changing address or not, I am not in support of it. And, you know, I think that's the ideal way to go. Now, this is because even though we need the elderly presence around us, we have to be very careful. Now, we have to be very careful in the sense that now it's very instructive to learn from elders and to learn from those who have gone ahead of us. But whilst we are learning, we should also consider what is best for our people. So we should not leave the whole decision-making to those elders.
Right. I'm sorry to cut you short. I just want to, maybe check if Femi has a rebuttal to what you just said. Femi, do you agree with what Bayo just said about the disparity between, clearly differentiating between godfatherism and mentorship?
Mentors. Yes, very correct. You know, I was, he said something and he's trying to indict me. So let me explain that. I'm trying to take out my activist part. No. I mean, just for this discussion, you understand? So I agree totally with him. And there's this part where he mentioned that elders and all of that, that we do not take them out. There is this popular saying in Yoruba that omode gbon agbagbon la fi dale ife. So omode gbon agbagbon means, it's democracy, like bringing everybody together. It is not that. That saying is not that agbade, agba wapache, something like that.
So others are more wiser.
Yes. What that saying is explaining is that you have people coming together in a community. You know, it's communalism, and they are bringing their decisions together. It is not that the elders are sitting, you know, on a higher stool and then just dishing out directives. Do you get it? And I think I agree with you.
Right, Larry, I hope you're about to chat so we can help us decipher this. But besides that, so one of the many things that I contend with, and I'm arguing with some of my colleagues here, they are not African, about, you know, the the influence of godfathers in African politics, they usually tell me that, well, you got to look at the cultures in Africa and the religious interpretations or religious dogma in Africa. And frankly, some of these religious dogmas and cultural provisions provide that people do respect their elders. In fact, we must place elders in the highest levels of power. And if you have an elder, well, regardless of if the person is an elder or not, whomever is in power, elderly or not elderly, you must regard them, you must respect them, and you must, to some extent, not question their authority, because of course they do know more than you do. Those are cultural provisions in West Africa. Religious provision in Islam and Christianity inquire people, or, you know, admonish people to be submissive to their leaders. I can't remember the Bible verse that says, you know, you must, you know, look up to your elders and your leaders and regard them. The same thing in the Quran. So, Larry, I don't think you are a religious, a spiritual person, or you are a pastor.
I'm not
a Yoruba teacher, but can you help us, you know, understand the role or the impacts of religious provisions and cultural provisions as regards submissiveness to elders and regarding them as perhaps a reason why Godfatherism is so ingrained in the politics of Africa, particularly Nigeria?
I think that may have added to it. I mean, our cultural and religious beliefs may have added to why Godfatherism is entrenched in Nigerian politics, but I do not think that's the main reason, because politics is a game of influence, especially when it comes to party politics. Because, I mean, yes, the people would vote, but when it comes to inside party politics, you realize that it's much more about influence. And maybe religious and cultural beliefs of we giving respect and being submissive to our elders has a role to play, but I don't think that's why Godfatherism is entrenched in politics in Nigeria. I think Godfatherism is entrenched in politics in Nigeria much more because it's a game of influence. For instance, I happen to have a friend who, I mean, is a politician, a young Nigerian, and when he was going to run for the state House of Assembly, but he lost at the primary levels. And then I had conversations with him. And I got to know that the reason he lost, even though he was loved, the reason he lost was because a day or two before the election, one man moved from supporting him to another. And that man took about 30 or 20, 30, 40, 50% of the votes that was supposed to be for him. And if that man hadn't moved from supporting him or hadn't changed his direction or his support, he would probably would have won the ticket. And most likely, because the person who had it is the one in the office right now. So I think that it's much more because politics is much more about influence, is about influencing people, is about games, is about, you know, I think it's more for those reasons than because, yes, our cultural beliefs is, and a particular thing is also that people who are involved, who participate in politics are not highly educated people. I mean, and this, because they are not highly educated, most of these people still have these beliefs of submission. You have to respect your elders. Of course, we have to respect your elders. Of course, I think that's a global belief. But I think more it is because politics is about influence than it is cultural or religious beliefs. That's my view.
Right. So, Daniel, do you agree with Femi? I'm sorry, Larry. So
I would like to partly agree with Larry, but in the other part when he was talking about political literacy, I think I would beg to differ. So I quite agree with your submission, Ibrahim. What I would say is that, for instance, look at the issue. Let me use the issue of Oshiomhole and Obaseki as a clear example. It is believed, so to say, that when an elder gives, let's say, directions or decisions or admonitions or suggestions, even if you don't really agree, you should at least follow it. Then probably after a while, you can now later say, okay, you are not you understand, but at the first instance you are expected to koto, so to say. So when the younger one or the godson disagrees, then it leads to a fight, or it leads to let's say a disagreement. The elder person says, oh, this person has disrespected me, and I'm going to show him, in quote. So it is, I think it is first a cultural belief that has been passed over the years, or don't let me say cultural belief. Let me say it's a societal issue that has now been entrenched in the minds and orientation of the people. So when you see something reoccurring, like you see a trend reoccurring, people regard it as the norm. So a young boy coming up, even in Nigerian politics, look towards some people. Okay, when I get to a certain age, I'll go to someone for tutelage to mentor me, how to probably convince the electorate, how to assess funds, how to do all those things. You understand? Some people aspire to get to be mentored, to be tutored by tutored in quotes now by the political elite. So I think it's a societal issue, and I quite agree with also what you said about religious sentiments and cultural ideology. I think it's all these issues encompassing. It's all encompassing, and it is what has shaped the ideas, the ideology, and the views of people over the years. So it has become entrenched. I think that's just a simple comment I have on that.
Right. So Femi, are you going to sit on the fence with Daniel, even though the fence might not be too strong, or are you going to outrightly, you know, concede to the fact that it could be possibly because of mass political illiteracy, or because we are so religious and so ingrained in cultural provisions for us to comply with the so-called elderly advice and elderly leadership? Femi.
All right. I think what we're doing here is to x-ray, you know, the whole issues, and not to, maybe at the end, we have that part of that section of this session where we then prescribe. I think that's what we're doing. Yes, I agree that it's a cultural thing. Yeah, it's a cultural thing. And what do you call culture? Way of life, you know, over time. This is what you hear at home. You know, respect your elders. When you get to the church, only if you just center, they tell you the same thing. When you get to school, you hear the same thing. And what we call respect here is that you listen to them, everything they say. You know, respect normally should be mutual. That where you sit, that's why I use that saying, you know, there's this. But it's just that we've discarded some of our, you know, things that are very, very African. We were not brought up that way to always take things hook, line, and sinker. I think that's not really us until we got to that point. So it is cultural. And on that part of political literacy, I think I need to ask everyone on this panel, do you know who came third? Who came third during the last election, the third position? Everyone would think it's Showore, but sincerely, it's not Showore. It's one man who never campaigned. That's Nicholas Felix. Nicholas Felix smartly took over 200 or close to 200,000 votes from Atiku's votes. And what did he do? This man never campaigned. He never appeared on TV and all of that. The name of his party is PCP. And the color, the logo, everything looks like that of the PDP. So it's to tell you that you are talking about a society where you have 13.5 million children out of school. You're talking about a society where even those who are not out of school are out of education. People cannot actually look at a ballot paper and then, you know, put their thumb to the right. So it tells you what there is problem in the society. So there is serious illiteracy. I agree with what Mr. Larry said. There is serious illiteracy. So a man who never campaigned and all of that had more votes than Fela Dro Toye, Kingsley Moalu, and Showore put together. It's to tell you that you are in a society, and that's why I don't want us to deviate. But one reason I had a discussion with someone before this session, and it's the fact that I don't think democracy is yet for this kind of society. Because in a democracy, you need enlightened people, you know. It's a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. So the people must know that it is their government. But in a case where people are ignorant of a government that exists, they do not even understand that the reason why they are suffering is due to the failure of government. They think it's destiny. So people are not conscious enough. I think I don't want to deviate, but I think what we need might just be a benevolent dictator, maybe someone like Thomas Sankara. But it's just to tell you that what we have is. It's cultural, definitely, which should be discarded. You know, it's a way of life. If people decide today that they don't want to live that kind of way anymore, it's yes, culture can be discarded. And there is serious political illiteracy in this society.
Well, I hope you don't wake Thomas Sankara up from his grave. But so, Femi, you may mention of something about democracy is bad for Nigeria, or Nigeria is not ready for democracy. Are you trying to be Aristotle here? Because Aristotle also do not believe in democracy. So do you think Nigeria, you know, is not best, we would not be best represented in a democracy?
Yes, it has not worked, quote unquote. Or let me say, for this kind of society, where you have mass illiteracy, mass poverty, which are products, you know, the first thing everyone wants to be free, or every group of people who wants to be free must first acquire is, you know, education. That's it. When people are not educated, you can toss them around anyhow. And that's what the elites in this society are using as the middle class. The people who have gone to school also should be able to step in to assist the people who are, you know, below. But you have them on Twitter, we see them on Facebook spewing trash, spewing nonsense about issues. And then you begin to, you know, appreciate, quote unquote, the kind of dilemma we find ourselves. So in this kind of society, I am just proposing, I've not refined this in my head, but I'm just proposing that it seems democracy is not yet such for a society where you have, you know, this kind of backwardness.
What do you
propose? No, like I said, I've not refined it.
Okay, what are you refining currently? What do you
refine it? That's what I said. What do you say?
What do you think now? I mean, if you say we should just do away with democracy, what do you think we can use?
No, I'm not saying we should do away with democracy.
Okay.
What I'm saying is that I do not think democracy, as in this society, is fit for democracy. Because what we are practicing actually is not democracy. We all know that. But I don't think a society that is this backward, for example, look at policies. I know we've gone to school, we've seen all these things run. For example, in the US, policies are debated in schools. You know, university students, you see them. I just wrote an essay for a student studying in the US. And the topic of that essay has to do with governance, politics. This is someone in biological sciences. They give them a topic to debate. But you even have a university here in Nigeria where things like that don't happen. No political education. Students are just left, you know, to decide which idea they can run with. That's the truth.
Right.
So in this kind of society, what I'm just thinking is that it's so backward that democracy is not, people don't understand that it is their government yet, that they make up the government. That's not the truth.
All right. So Bayo, I don't know if Daniel also have a counter argument, but Bayo, the floor is not open anyway. So Bayo, Daniel, do you agree with the way Femi is questioning Nigeria's democracy? Or do you know?
I will agree with him. I think what Femi is trying to say, if I may just summarize it, is that the issue is systemic. So when we were talking about the university situation, even if you look at how the university administration sometimes is run in Nigeria, it's even autocratic, like it's authoritative. Sometimes they don't hear the views of the students. They make decisions that You know, it just affects students in all ramifications, and they don't care. So I don't want to overgeneralize, but it's the reality in Nigeria. You sample the universities. So I think if you look at this from the grassroots, the trend reoccurs till the ends of affair, the highest term of affair. So I think it's systemic, and I think what we need, what I have always said is, I don't know how feasible it is right now, but we need mass orientation, strong public awareness, good and quality education, not only just going to school. I think the problem is far from just going to school now, because even if you look at this, the Nigerian face now is in shambles. So it's so worrisome.
Okay, so Bayo, do you agree with both Femi and Daniel, or do you have any negative
yes, view? I agree with them partly on the issue of democracy not fit for an uninformed society like ours. I also agree with them on the fact that it is systemic, but I do not agree with them on the fact that the university or the educational system is not providing enough, is not playing its part. Honestly, I am saddened with that, with the fact that year in, year out, undergraduates, you know, embark on final year projects. And you see, at the end of that project, they end up, say, they give recommendations. Most of what these recommendations says is that you know, most times they tend to attribute some of this, the solution to some of these problems to government. Now, Femi pointed the fact that, okay, in Western education world, where university students are the ones who, you know, determine the direction of policies, they debate it, they, you know, and all that. Nigeria has a, you know, a heap of educational material to consume, to direct or reshape its politics. Political scientists in Nigerian universities have tons of ideas lying fallow in the libraries, unused, untapped, unassessed. And there's nothing anybody is doing about that. And that's because we do not value the kind of education that we have. Now, whilst we need to restructure the kind of education that we have to be able to fit in for the kind of society that we are in, the kind of education that we need is one that will drive our own development, not a replicative education, or not this monotonous, stereotypic form of learning. We need a form of education that is fit for our society, that will help the society to develop. Now, this same education should be able to translate into societal actions. But you see, people write projects, thousands of Nigerian graduate writes projects every year, every semester, and they put it on the shelf. They put it in the libraries. The government is not using it. So, whilst in the Western world, the government even comes to the university because they believe they trust in the system to be able to give them the valuable, the tested, you know, the viable option. All right, now this still boils down to the fact that it is systemic. It is because we do not value education. It is because we have not done enough orientation. It is because we have not grasped the need for us to be educated enough for us to drive a democratic society. If not, politicians will look back into universities, into academic institutions, for them to tap into policies that these young persons are thinking of. It is systemic.
Baman, give this man two voices of origin.
Okay, so Larry, I don't know if you're going to agree with both of the three of them, but I want a different question, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
Of course, organize your media. Your organization has a media outlet that is always present on the streets of Ibadan and Lagos, asking questions.
Yeah.
And from what you've covered lately, do you think, you know, Nigerian youths are finally grasping the enormity of power that they wield in terms of election, determining the outcome of elections, or influencing electorates, oh, sorry, elected representatives to live by their manifestos? Do you think Nigerian youths finally understand this duty and the enormity of power they have, but, especially judging from the outcome of the Edo election? Larry?
Well, I do not think that Nigerian youth understand the power that they have yet. And why I do not think so is, for instance, let's look at the 2019 elections. Since 1999, last year, we had the lowest voter turnout. Without me researching on what demography came out to vote the most, I know for sure that because we have a high population of young people, I know for sure that a lot of young people didn't go out to vote. As Bayo said it, I like how he put it. He said that maybe democracy is not fit for an uninformed society like ours. And that's why I've always believed that Nigerians need to know. Nigerians need to, there is the need for orientation. There is the need for Nigerians to understand that we are the government. There's the need for Nigerians to know that the power lies with us. And I do not think that Nigerian youths understand that yet. And it makes me think that I do not know whose responsibility that is. My organization is doing a part that we can do, but we need to inform the people. The people need to know. The day things will change for the better for Nigeria is the day we all have an understanding that the power lies with us. And I think that's my view about that.
Right. So I just want us to bring everything home now. Each of you guys are involved with different youth organizations promoting the idea of freedom or responsible governance in your different capacities. So from what you guys have experienced in the last few years, what can you say of the future of Nigerian politics? Do you see the nearest future as one that will be determined by the will of the youths, the will of the electorate generally, or an outcome that will still be confined to the caprices of the godfathers?
What I think I've observed at least three state elections in Nigeria. I was in Osun, I was in Ekiti, and I was in Kogi last year. I was not in Edo because of some reasons. So at least I have a fair understanding of the electoral, at least in recent times, issues of around the election. What I would say is I still sincerely believe that the electorate hold the maximum or the highest power, but it is now using it correctly that determines the outcome of elections. So there are usually cases of vote buying, money politics, vote selling. What are the reasons for this? Poverty, lack of education, and all that. But because the people do not know that what they carry in their hands could change their lives drastically for the better, they do not know. So they are willing to let go for 500 naira. I witnessed it in some in the states. I actually witnessed it. 500 naira, as low as 500 naira. Some people sell their votes. Youth and some adults also sell for prices around 3K, 5K. So it's worrisome. It's lack of education. It's like going back to education, but I don't want to deviate. So what I believe is the electorate, as we saw in Edo now, nobody would argue that the Edo state election was rigged. Even though there were allegations that some foul play could occur before, prior to the election. But from the outcome of the election, we saw that there was no rigging, and at least even if there were some violence, it didn't really affect the outcome of the election. So I would say the electorate have highest or maximum power, but they really need to know the power they carry to be a key determinant in the outcomes of the election. Thank you.
All right. So the election was rigged or not, though, that's still a matter of questioning.
Of course. Yeah.
You know, maybe because it is now the PDP a PDP favored outcome. Maybe that same is not. Anyways, what I want to ask.
Well, some observers are of the opinion that at least it wasn't. So I don't know.
Okay.
Elections are decided by the Supreme Court, after the people.
But anyway, Femi and Abayo.
Yeah.
Hold on, Femi, sorry. Factoring in the elements of poverty and mass political literacy, do you think, considering these two factors, you can actually say, maybe not entirely confidently, but hopefully, that moving forward, Nigerian political, structure and political outcomes would always be one that represents the will of the youth, the will of the electorate? Or are we still going to be modeled through the so-called, structuring and engineering of the so-called godfathers, Femi and Bayo?
You see, we're limiting political discussions to elections. Most times that's what we do in this society. When we don't talk about politics, the only thing that comes to our mind is elections, and that's why after the elections, everybody go to sleep, and then these guys mess up for another 4 years. Then they come back to us again, and then so we've reduced political discussions. We've reduced political consciousness to just elections. We do not take activism. We do not take holding them, accountable at all points. We do not take it as a political activity. But let me just say this, and I think it's in wrapping up, that except the revolution of this system, electoral system, which is just a section of the political and economic system that has been run in this country, will take us nowhere. The judicial system is being run by these people. They own the banks, they own the businesses, they own everything. So until we have a revolution of the people, we might just be psychomambulating, moving around circles. That's the truth. You change, and that's what, there are two questions in this. There is a want to change question, and there is a what to change question. These are two things. But we made that mistake in 2015, in the 2015 elections with Buhari. Everybody just wanted Jonathan out of power. If a goat had contested against Jonathan, Nigerians would have voted the goats. It was that bad. People just wanted, so we did not interrogate the kind of change coming in. So that was the womb to change question. We only wanted to change the person, do you get it? But there is a what to change, and that is the system itself. The system that makes sure, that is making sure that as we are speaking, as I'm talking to you right now, people are stealing from Nigeria. That until we have an overhaul of the system, you know, the political and the economic system that we run, you understand, we'll just keep moving around circles. And today, the Coalition for Revolution launched a charter for liberation, total liberation, that has, you know, everything that is stated, how we can get out of this mess that we are. It's as simple as that. Or else, we just keep choosing between our oppressors, you know, one evil, a better evil, and another evil.
Before I come to Larry, Bayole, are you as skeptic of this current status quo as Femi is? Are you also in favor of this revolutionary removal of these godfathers and their cohorts?
Definitely, Ibrahim. You know, statistically speaking, 55% of the current population of Nigeria are young persons between the ages of 18 and 35. Now, 60% of Nigeria's economy depends on SME. These SMEs are driven by young persons. Now, I would have loved to mention names, but in this past weekend, there was a massive campaign for a particular action. And, you know, young persons came out to vote with their money for this particular activity, irregardless of how much it cost them. They were friends of rich people who gave money for people to vote. They were giving people food and giving them money to vote with money. Now, that shows you that young people can really drive a very successful activity. Now, that singular action made that young man win, whatever he wanted to win. You know, I don't want to mention names. But, you know, that shows you that young persons still have this power in their hands. And that shows you how much influence we can make if we just focus, bring in concerted effort, ensure that we are into, you know, we are mainstream into the economy. Two things are lacking. And that two things we have: number, influence, economy, education. Young people have all of this. So plunge yourself into business, make more money, plunge yourself into politics, and then you rid yourself of the godfathers. That's where you can put Nigeria soon.
Absolutely. I'm actually happy that I'm not the only one that doesn't like that show. It's so absurd to me. I don't even have time for it. But Larry, you heard what Bayole said. In a minute, can you just add to the fact to this narrative that, you know, Nigeria youths, they have the wherewithal to go and vote. They will not go and vote.
Yeah.
But when it comes to, you know, using their 15 naira or 100 naira to vote in a ridiculous show, they would do it. And you see the crazy number that went to that show. So it's a matter of we know what to do. We are not interested. Or it has not beaten us to the extent that we want to take action.
Well, I think that it's a matter of we not having an agreement. We have not yet agreed. I mean, for those ones, there's an agreement, there's what want. But for us, we have the numbers, and we probably know, but we have not yet agreed. And I also think that one of the problems is poverty. I mean, I know that we have mentioned that, but a lot of young Nigerians won't care about what they want to eat. They care about...
Mary, are you kidding me? These people, they are not getting anything from that show, and they are spending 15 naira to vote. And you are saying poverty, really?
I mean, we do not yet have an agreement. We're talking about transforming Nigeria now, you know, talking about changing things as we are. It's not that it hasn't beaten us. Everyone in Nigeria feels the hardship now. But, you know, there's the thing about hardship. When it pushes to the wall, you turn your face at it. Unfortunately, young Nigerians voted for that show, but they won't come out to vote here. So until we have that agreement, because you see some young Nigerians are benefiting from the corrupt system, so they won't support that. So that's what I mean by until we have that agreement to want to change, until there is that agreement amongst we young Nigerians, nothing is going to change.
Yeah, I mean, I think at this point, we should hire the I'm going to name names now. We should hire the leader of multi-choice to help us draft people agreement so that we can agree on how to act sensibly. So, Daniel, I'm going to give you the last salvo. So what do you have to say about, you know, the Femi's skepticism and Larry's partial skepticism and Bayole's, partial skepticism? Are you going to be the one optimist about the contribution of Nigerian youth now? Daniel?
Yeah, so not to regard myself as any skeptic. What I would say is, generally, I would say I'm optimistic, but I really don't see the light. I'm optimistic as a person, but I don't see the light in the Nigerian state right now. So until we decide collectively to take matters into our hands and decide to push for change, whichever means it occurs, maybe waiting till 2023 and
it's a revolution.
Why should I wait till
2023 if I can be free today? Why do I have to wait?
Democratically elected. So I think there's also the argument that we don't want to plunge the country into chaos.
Definitely, the people can democratically remove the government.
I think that's an argument.
All right, gentlemen. this is an interesting conversation. We don't want to go above our time. And so there you have it. Yeah. A discussion about Godfatherism in Nigeria from, four interesting young men and, people actually driving discussion around youth responsibility in politics and governance. I appreciate your time, Femi, Bayonle, Daniel, and of course, Larry. You guys are really amazing.